Now we have come to week two once again in Victorious Secrets. I believe today, as I prayed and as I sought the Lord on what to share, I believe today that the Lord is truly going to speak, amen, to your hearts. But today, of course, as we go into Samson's secret, I came across a quote that I absolutely love, and it's from Benjamin Franklin, and it says, three may keep a secret if two of them are dead. Three may keep a secret if two of them are dead. Secrets are sometimes hard to keep, yet most times they're better to keep. Especially if a secret doesn't hurt someone else, or it isn't biblically wrong, or it would affect your relationship. Sometimes some things are better kept. Somebody holler and say, I know that's right. Sometimes some things are better kept. Not that you want to be deceptive, but you understand that you can't tell everyone everything, because if they discover the thing that you have as a secret, especially those things. Now, I know that there are people that may not be believers in here, and you may not be familiar with the church thing, but for those of us that understand that God will speak to us, God will show us certain things, and where we go wrong is that we begin to tell people the thing that God has spoken to us even before God wants us to reveal those things. Can I just tell you, when you reveal secrets too soon, especially, let me give you an example, when it comes to your dreams and ambitions, can I just tell you, when you reveal secrets too soon, and sometimes you've got so much haters that are around you that disguise themselves as people that for you, the moment you reveal those secrets, they can cause those things to be miscarried even before the time comes. Look at your neighbor, say, he preaching already. He preaching. Hallelujah. And so there's some secrets that you can't, amen, tell people. Just ask Joseph, and he's a familiar character, but just ask Joseph. Joseph will tell you that there's sometimes even the closest people to you will be jealous of the things that God shows you. And so there are people that they may not have a problem with your dream, but watch this, y'all. They'll have a problem with their position in your dream. Oh man, that's good. They don't have a problem that you're a dreamer, but they'll have a problem of the position that they got in your dream. Because Joseph's brothers didn't have a problem that he had a dream. They had a problem that they were the ones bowing down to him in the dream. Can I just tell you, some of you are set up for greatness. God has spoken some things for you. God has deposited some things in your spirit. But there are some of you that have caused those dreams to be, watch this, not denied, but delayed because you talk too much. And so some secrets are better kept. Look at somebody, say, you better keep that secret. You know, when I think about it, even in the food industry, they understand that in order for you to keep the monopoly on the market, you have to keep your recipes protected. Because people will cut you out the picture if they make their food taste exactly like yours. Can I just tell y'all something? The reason why God will show you something and he don't show nobody else, because that's the thing that will help to set you apart from everybody else. I don't know if I'm talking to people in here who understand, you're not ordinary. Look at your neighbor and say, you're not ordinary. Hallelujah. And because you're not ordinary, God will give you some things that are specific to you. Amen. But if you tell people those things, watch this, they are either going to try to miscarry the dream, or they're going to try to duplicate and be a carbon copy, and they mess things up for you because it was in their place to even get that position in the first place. And so the fast food restaurants take this seriously. Amen. They have secret sauces and secret seasonings that they keep to themselves because it will bankrupt them, especially if you're a franchise. Because McDonald's, amen, y'all know they Big Mac carrying on. McDonald's have a secret sauce for they Big Mac, amen. And some people looking what they made up, but so what? I will eat my Big Mac in front of you, amen. And y'all know that just be juicy and dripping, but it's that secret sauce that makes Big Mac what it is. Kentucky Fried Chicken got its 11 herbs and spices. And to this day, I've been looking on the market and online, amen, to clone the 11 herbs and spices. I came to one site and it says that one of the missing spices that Kentucky don't tell you that they have is dirt. I say, man, these people. See, because everyone's trying to figure out what the secret is to that finger licking good chicken. And then, of course, Pizza Hut. How much of y'all like Pizza Hut? Hallelujah. Now, Nassau, they only got Domino's and Marco's. But I don't care how much pizza shop you open, you can't make your dough or your crust taste like Pizza Hut crust. I mean, and that stuff is bad for you because you got all the oil leaking out when you eating that thing and all that grease. And I mean, and you on your way to a heart attack, but it tastes so good. Hallelujah. Amen. But as a result, y'all watch this because I'm going someplace. I don't want you to miss it. Amen. But can I just tell you, as a result, amen, of their secret, as a result of them protecting themselves, they have set themselves apart to the point that McDonald's is in 119 countries across 35,000 outlets and had an annual revenue of $27.5 billion and profits of $5.5 billion. Watch this. All they sell is burgers, but they got a secret to their sauce. Can I just tell you, KFC is the world's second largest restaurant chain after McDonald's, with 18,875 outlets in 118 countries and territories. Why is it that people just don't open up their own chicken franchises without bothering with KFC's, amen, 11 herbs and spices? Why? Because the secret is so good. They understand that if I could get the chicken to taste just like that, then I could be successful too. Why? Because there is a secret to their victory. There's a secret to their success. Look at somebody, say, do you have a secret? Hallelujah. Pizza Hut, made up of 10,000 restaurants, delivery carryout units in all 50 states of the United States and 80 foreign countries. Look at somebody, say, I want to know their secret. I want to know. Hallelujah. And so because these, amen, franchises have these secrets, it has set them apart. Amen. And I believe today that God wants us to be set apart. God has given us, amen, the ability to see the secret things. In 1 Corinthians, it says this, that God has revealed to us the secret things that even may seem foolishness to the things of this world. Amen. But can I just tell you all, the secret things that God's given us will confound the wise. God wants to do something in your life that will set you apart. Now then, we've reached this narrative in Judges chapter 16 verse 6, and we come in the middle of this familiar narrative, amen, of course, where Delilah says to Samson, oh my dear, could you please tell me the secret of your strength and how you could be tied up and humbled. Some scripture verses or some translation says tied up and tortured. She crazy. Look at somebody say, she crazy. She crazy. Amen. I could have just imagined something. Hey, baby. But this woman was crazy. But now, y'all, for those of you that may not be familiar with church, you didn't grow up in Sunday school, amen, 101. Can I just tell you, I don't like coming in the middle of movies, amen. As a matter of fact, when I go to the movies, I won't go to the pre-show, amen. I want to make sure I have time to go to the concession stand to buy my popcorn, my nachos, amen, and get a comfortable seat. Because you know when it's a good movie, everyone will pack the movie theater, and I hate having to sit all the way to the front. And so I won't get to the movie early, but then if I come in the middle of a movie, I don't appreciate the movie because I need to understand how this thing got started. What was the setup to get them to the place that they are? And so what was the setup? What was it that got Samson to this place where he's lying in the lap of a woman called Delilah and she is asking him the secret to his strength? Well, I'm glad y'all are so interested in Samson. Amen. Because a lot of you already believe that I'm going to hit straight to Delilah. But can I just tell you, his life is so magnanimous. His life is so huge and so big and so filled and pregnant with preaching possibilities that I would have to literally spend 3 sermons just to get to Delilah. But can I just tell y'all, it didn't start with him lying in Delilah's lap. Amen. This push for his secret didn't start right in Judges chapter 16. It started in Judges chapter 13. There was a period in Israel history where God didn't use kings to rule. He didn't use prophets at this moment as much, but God used judges. Everybody say judges. There was the kings, there was the patriarchs, there was the judges. And so God at this moment has used judges. Come here, women. I told y'all last week there are strong sisters, amen, all around. around in our 21st century and in biblical context. There was a judge by the name of Deborah. Y'all remember Deborah? Amen. She was a sister and she was a judge. So women can be used by God. But brothers, I'm speaking a little bit more to us today. Amen. But here it is now. We have reached the period of the judges. And Samson was one of those judges. And now here in Judges chapter 13, we will see now that God had now given Israel the ability to have judges raised up so that they could conquer the enemies that they have gotten bound to. Here's what was happening. Every time God set Israel free, they go ahead and do foolishness and found themselves messed back up in the same predicament. And then God, after they would pray and repent, would say, okay, I'll raise up somebody to deliver you. Y'all missing it already. Can I just tell y'all, so many times we do things over and over and over and over again. We know the end result, but yet God is so good and God is so merciful and God is so gracious that no matter how much times we get ourselves in the same things, he always seems to get us out, man. About five of us should be shouting right there. Amen. Y'all church folk like act so safe, but y'all know, amen, you make some stupid decision and you know what the end result is going to be. But thank God for grace and thank God. I just need about 10 people to stand to your feet and give God praise that no matter how much times you get yourself in mess, he keeps getting you out. Look at somebody, say, he preaching to you, amen, and not me. He preaching to you and not me. But God is that kind of God where he'll get us out of our precarious predicaments. And so here it is now, amen, in Judges chapter 13, amen, verse 2 to 5, God shows up to a man by the name of Manoah, amen, that was Samson's daddy. He shows up to a man by the name of Manoah and he says to him, amen, because his wife, of course, was barren, he said to him that I am going to give you a child. God appeared to a barren woman in the middle of a precarious predicament for Israel, and even though she was barren, God says, I'm going to give you a child. I want to say something prophetic to somebody in here. Amen. You've been feeling like things weren't going the way you wanted them to go. You've been feeling stuck like Chuck. It seemed like every door that you expected to be open has been closed in your face. It seems like your life is at a standstill and nothing has happened. Can I just say amen and make a prophetic declaration? Prepare for a visitation. Look at your neighbor, say, God's getting ready to visit you. Hallelujah. Prepare for a visitation. Y'all watch. Let's let the text preach for itself. He says, amen, his wife was barren and childless. The angel of God appeared to her and told her, I know that you are barren and childless, but you are going to become pregnant and bear a son. He says, but take much care. Drink no wine or bread. Eat nothing ritually unclean. You are in fact pregnant right now. Oh my God, Father, I wish I had a church in here today. Amen. Can I just tell somebody that came inside here? I know you may feel like nothing's been happening for you, but God wants you to know, amen, the secret's out. Hallelujah. You're pregnant right now. Amen. God has deposited something on the inside of you. Amen. That's about to change your life in the next few months. Look at your neighbor, say, you're pregnant and don't even know it. Hallelujah. Amen. Fellas, I know that may be, amen, just specific to women. But can I just tell y'all, I'm speaking about spiritual pregnancy. Amen. Because there are some things that God will deposit in your spirit. And God says, you know what? I'm going to cause you to give birth to something greater than you thought you could have even imagined or dreamed for yourself. Look at your neighbor and prophesy to them and say, you're pregnant right now. Hallelujah. Amen. Spiritually, baby, you pregnant right now. Spiritually, spirit. We got too much children, so spiritually. Hallelujah. If you a husband, amen, and you next to your wife, just say to her, spiritually, spiritually. Hallelujah. Amen. You're pregnant right now, carrying a son. No razor will touch his head. The boy will be God's Nazarite. From the moment of his birth, he will be launched. He will launch the deliverance from the Philistine oppression. Can I just tell y'all, amen, from Samson was born, God says that this boy will be used for my glory. He was a Nazarite. If you're taking notes, when you think about Nazarites, there are three things about Nazarites. One, they must not drink fermented drinks. No alcohol must touch their lips. Two, amen, they must not touch anything dead or unclean or eat it. And then three, amen, I know it's 1, 1, 1, but just add it all together and it makes 3. Hallelujah. Amen. They must not touch anything dead or unclean or eat it. And then 3, they must not cut their hair. Samson, amen, had now been dedicated to God because at a young age, God spoke to his mother. Can I just tell some of you who've been in church, but you're de-churched right now? You may not know it, but I believe that there were some grandparents and some parents praying for you. The reason why, no matter how far you find yourself from God, something keeps drawing you in. Amen. Some Sundays you just wake up and say, I know I ain't where I supposed to be. Amen. But I think I'm gonna go to the house of the Lord. Let me tell you why. Because from you were young and in your parents' womb, I believe that there was some praying parents. Amen. There was some praying grandparents. Is there anybody in here thankful that you had some praying grandparents, some praying parents? See, from you were in your mother's womb. Here's why I came this morning with such fervency and fire. Because God wants me to let you know that there is too much deposited in your life for it to be miscarried. And he's not about to let you lose. He's about to give you victory that you never thought you would have had yourself. Because why? There's too much at stake on your life. Hallelujah. Somebody holler, preach, young man. I'm doing the best I can. And so now here it is from a young boy. Amen. Samson was dedicated to God. Samson, amen, had the hand of God on his life. He was a church boy. And watch this, y'all. He even went to church camp and the whole nine yards. Because the Bible starts to talk about how, and I'm telling y'all, read the story of Samson. Can I just tell you, how much of y'all ever watch Scandal? How much of y'all ever watch Scandal? Amen. How much of y'all never watch Scandal? Raise your hand. Amen. Can I just tell you, don't watch it. Don't watch it. You're going to be hooked. You're going to be hooked. I sat down and I watched Scandal the whole season in one day. Amen. My wife came to me and said, boy, you need to bed. I on vacation. I going to watch Scandal all day. Amen. Soon as one episode over, I say, man, I ain't trying to watch the next one. I gonna eat. And then all of a sudden I say, no, eating to come the next day. Hallelujah. That's how serious Scandal is. But can I just tell y'all, when you read, amen, Judges, when you read this text, if you read from Judges 13 to Judges 16, I mean, you're gonna be like, whoa, what? And you ain't gonna want to stop reading. Because watch this, this boy was in church. Everybody say church boy. Can I just tell y'all, contrary to, amen, what you may believe, some of the nastiest people, amen, watch this, they grow right up in church. It get quiet in here. Some of the most miserable people, some of the meanest and nastiest people will grow up in church. Because while they were in church, church wasn't in them. But this boy grew up in church. As a matter of fact, man, his parents said to, amen, his parents said to God, his parents said, God, you got to teach us how to raise this boy. In Judges chapter 13, his mom and his dad prayed, God, you got to teach us how to raise him because we can't do this on our own. There are some parents in here even now. I believe some of your stress is related to your children. Some of your stress is related to that rebellious child, that child that giving you high blood pressure. Can I just tell you, sometimes you just got to get on your knees and commit that child to God. Amen. You've just got to say, God, I can't do it on my own. I can't do it by myself. I am putting them in your his mom. Watch this, we never get her name, but we do find out the characteristics that is powerful. She's not as popular as Hannah. She is not as popular as Rizpah, because the Bible doesn't even give us this woman's name, but the Bible says that she was a praying woman. And she says, God, You got to help me raise this boy. And so as the text goes on, amen, the Bible says that the woman gave birth to a son. She named him Samson. The boy grew and God blessed him. And the Spirit of God worked on him while he was staying at a Dinite camp. And I tell y'all, he was so saved that he was in Bible camp. The Spirit of the Lord worked on him while he was a little boy. Amen. Can I just tell some of you, some of your greatest memories were when you were a teenager, when you were, amen, a child growing up in church, and you know there was something significant about your life. You know there was something special about your life. This boy was so set apart that God says, I'm going to protect you, I'm going to keep you, because I can't afford for you to become ordinary. Can I just help some of your parents out real quick? I hope I got enough teenagers in here. But can I just tell you the reason why your curfew ain't as late as everybody else's curfew? It's because your parents don't want you to be like everybody else. You're going to be set apart. The reason why you can't go over to everybody's house and sleep over to everybody's house, even though they children sleeping over to everybody else, because you're set apart. You ain't going to be ordinary. Amen. You are something special. Get mad if you want to. My grandmother used to say, Dury, you're special. Amen. I know you a boy. I know you in grade 12, but it's Friday, 11:30. You better be in my house. I could never, amen, look at my grandmother with a hard face. One time, Sister Jackie, I tripped right out in church. Amen. My grandmother was in the hallway and she say something to me and I was feeling myself because I had a couple little friends around me and I sucked my teeth. My grandmother literally stopped with her big hat. She do one of these turns. And she say, we live right up the road from the church, could have walked to the church. She say, Dury, go home. Go in the tub and stay in the tub until I come home. See y'all 21st century children, y'all 90s babies, y'all got it real good. Hallelujah. I grew up with my grandparents and they never, you could afford to call social services, call the police, because when the police reach, they can help them beat you. Can I just tell y'all, I was set apart. What was my grandmother doing? My grandmother was saying, Dury, no. There's something special on you. And I refuse to let you become ordinary. Can I just tell you, I'm not just speaking to teenagers at this moment, but can I just tell some of us that are adults, that are children of God, sometimes God will do some things to us. God will say some stuff to us. God will require something more of us. So what? Amen. Everybody else doing it. God requires more of you. Just because they up in the club don't mean you gotta be in the club. God requires more of you. Just because everybody else shacking up before they get married to test the waters, God requires more of you. I know we in a contemporary church and y'all believe relevant means to be compromising, but no, baby. Can I just tell you, Relevant Kingdom Center, we are not ordinary and God requires more of us. It's time to grow up. It's time to put some things down. It's time to turn our lives in the direction that God wants us to turn in. He requires. Hey. Hallelujah. I know if you can't say amen, just amen, say ouch. Amen. You can't be like every other girl in the world. No, he requires more. You can't be like every other man. Amen. That doing whatever they want, treating their family however they want. No, God requires more. Hallelujah. Look at somebody, say, he requires more. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, amen, giving your heart to God is not for those that are weak. Amen. Because sometimes you're going to have to get cut. You know what Romans 12 says. He says, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. Hallelujah. Y'all know sacrifice hurts, right? Yeah, y'all know sacrifice ain't easy, right? From Samson was a boy, God says, Samson, I'm requiring more of you. You ain't gonna be like every other boy because there's something great that is set up for you. Come, hallelujah. Who am I preaching to today? Amen. Can I just tell y'all, when you get to the place God wants you to get, just be prepared because he's about to do something incredible in your life. Spirit of the Lord, began working on him, working through him. From he was a little boy. And now, amen, can I just tell you, the Lord blessed him. Amen. The Lord moved on him, moved through him. And it's not in chapter 16, though, his secret is revealed, but rather it is right here in these last few chapters of chapter 13. If Delilah was around and she could have read this story, amen, she would have not waited until the 16th chapter to realize where his secret was, because maybe you've missed it. But this was where Samson's secret really lies. Amen. Can I just tell y'all? Amen. His secret did not really just lie in his hair. His hair was a part of the secret. It was a symbol of his commitment. Can I just tell y'all? I just gave y'all the word. Amen. But it was a symbol. Amen. Watch this. Here is his secret. His secret was his commitment. Can I just tell some of y'all who playing hokey pokey with God? The reason you weak is because, watch this, you always have one foot in and you got one foot out. You play the hokey pokey and think that's what it's all about. Amen. And can I just tell you, you wonder why your life is messed up. You wonder why your life ain't to the place that it should be. It's because, watch this, there is no commitment. You know what this symbol is? This symbol, whenever we marry people, we say, this ring doesn't make you married. This ring is a symbol. So when you put this ring on, people understand that this man is a committed man in a relationship to another woman. Amen. Why? Because his ring is a symbol. Watch this, of his commitment. Samson's hair was a symbol, hallelujah, of his commitment. Everybody say commitment. Amen. To God. And the problem with us in the 21st century is we're not committed. Hallelujah. We hear one day, and the next day it's on to the next one. But look at somebody, say, God requires more. Y'all thought Samson's secret was only his hair? Oh no. Can I just tell y'all? It's here in verses 24 through 25. Watch this. Here's the secret to his strength. The secret to his strength was God. God was the source of his strength. I don't know who I'm talking to today, but can I just tell, amen, about 15 of y'all, that the reason why you still alive, the reason why you ain't gone crazy yet, the reason why you ain't riddled with disease, the reason why you ain't inside, amen, some prison or some hospital laying up, is because you got a secret source, baby. And look at your neighbor and say, my source is God. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, my strength is God. Is there anybody here that could testify, if it had not been for God, you could be like poor and say, it is in him that I live and move and have my being. He is the strength of my life. He is the source of my strength. I need about 20 people to stand up and sit back down and say, he's my source. He's my source. He is my. Hallelujah. I know a lot of people wonder why you could go through what you've been through and you still standing strong. Look at somebody, say, I got a secret, baby. And my secret really ain't a secret at all, but it's God who is behind my life. It was God who was keeping me strong. It was God that in the times that I cried myself to sleep still woke me up, and I found joy where I didn't know joy was. I got peace where I didn't know I could have had peace, all because of God. Hallelujah. Can I just tell y'all, I can't believe you're sitting there like that. Amen. Is there anybody here, if you just wish another flashback of where you was and you could consider where you are now, can I just tell you, they don't understand why you praise God the way you praise God. They don't understand why you gotta clap your hands and shout, but say, baby, if you know what I've been through, if you know what I came out of, you would be giving God praise for me. Is there anybody up in here that can miss another flashback? I just need 20 crazy believers to, let's take a couple second praise break and give God praise for being the source of your. They've been wondering, Sister Brown, what been keeping you, amen. But tell them it's the source of your strength. They've been wondering, amen, sister, what, how you been making it, how you could still have a smile on your face. It's the source of my strength. No matter what came my way, no matter what happened to me, can I just tell you, it was God. So if they take away anything, if you allow them to take away anything in your life, people of God, can I just tell you, don't let them take away God. Hallelujah. Don't let the circumstances of life cause you to walk out on God. Don't let people and things discourage you from your commitment to God. Let them take your money. Let them take your house. Let them take your car. But if it's one thing you want to hold on to, it's the fact that you've got God in your life. Somebody ought to preach, young man. I'm preaching better than y'all shouting up in here. Hallelujah. And so today, amen, can I just tell you, amen, that Samson now, amen, has gotten strength, not just because of his hair. His hair was a part of it. But Samson has gotten strength because he was committed to God from a young boy. Can I talk to some D-Church people right now that grew up in church? You're familiar with all of the lingo, the process, know some of the old hymns, "'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him by his word, just to know, amen, rest upon his promise, just to know what says the Lord." Some of y'all know all of these stuff, know all of the lingos, know all of the processes, but yet you still found out that regardless of all that, and as blessed as you were, you still were attracted to the wrong things. Because even though Samson knew his commitment was to God, watch this, y'all. See, Samson didn't just wake up in Delilah's lap the next day. This was a process. This was a, he came from a context. To Judges chapter 16, there was a context. Can I just tell everybody in here, everyone under the sound of my voice, the person sitting next to you, they came out of a context. That's why I tell you, don't make an internal indictment until you make an, don't make an external indictment until you make an internal investigation. Because everyone comes from a context. Some of y'all are so caught up in the external that you don't realize that there are some things on the internal that God needs to reveal to you. Because every one of us comes from a context. Sometimes we enshrine people without knowing their context. In other words, we think they God, but boy, you ain't know. They context. But then sometimes we demonize people because of their context. Amen. So, but everybody, say everybody. Everyone comes from a context. That's why you don't judge people by what you see. Watch this, y'all. It was a process. Everybody say process. So now we go to the next chapter of Judges. Amen. And watch this. We're in Judges chapter 14 now. And Samson, the Bible says, he went down to Timnah. Everybody say Timnah. There in Timnah, a woman caught his eye. A lot of you have walked away from the source and the secret of your strength because of something that caught your eye. Look at them. They mad. They come to church, God. Because I all up in their business. Something caught his eye. And so can I just tell y'all, amen, you got to be careful because now the devil, amen, will make things look good. But watch this. A Philistine girl, he came back and told his father and mother, "I saw a woman in." A Philistine girl, "Get her for me." I know some of y'all may say, "Why he tell he daddy get her for him? He saw thee." Instead, he go talk to that girl for himself, telling he daddy go get her. See, back in biblical antiquity, in this context and culture, it was the parents that would go and arrange marriages for their children. And so Samson was basically saying, "Daddy, I need you to go and get this girl for me." How much of y'all glad y'all ain't in that context? Because y'all parents would have picked some people that you would have already killed and been in jail for and... Yeah. Ooh, if your daddy set you up, then hey, I ain't preaching to you. I preaching to the person, the other person who daddy set them up. But so he says, Daddy, I want you to go and get her for me as my wife. Brothers, come here. I should just hit all the brothers over their head today so we could get some sense. Can I just tell y'all, brothers, amen, don't just go by what they look at on the outside. Brother, you better know who they are on the inside, because the prettiest girls on the outside could be some of the nastiest girls on the inside. Hallelujah. Don't worry, but her hair did, nails done, everything did. Amen. Go to her house. I bet you her bathroom nasty. I bet you, amen, her fuzzing full of dishes. I bet you she can't even take care, amen, or cook a meal. She'll burn up ramen noodles if she invites you to dinner. Hallelujah. Don't just go by what you see on outside. Look at somebody, say, this good, this good. Now, I know there's got to be physical attraction. Don't get me wrong, because y'all church people mix up. Oh, child, as long as he in the spirit, but he ugly or she uglier than I know what. Amen. When you wake up the next morning, you thought you had a nightmare. Amen. Because she's saying, hey, baby, and all of a sudden she say, boo. And you're like, ah! And you done get so drunk, you married. You done get a ring on your finger. You like, you come out of the movie hangover. Amen. You ain't know what you did last night. Yeah. Look at somebody, say, he preaching to you, not me. He preaching. He says, get up for me as my wife. His parents said to him, isn't there a woman among the girls in the neighborhood of our people? Can I just tell y'all, I told y'all he came out of a context. Y'all think this Delilah, but he this ain't even Delilah yet. Yeah. See, y'all thought he just ended up in Delilah's life. Laugh. Can I just tell every single one of you, one day you will wake up and you will wake up further than you expected to be. And it didn't happen overnight. You're going to see that. Watch this. Everybody look at somebody and say, this ain't Delilah yet. This ain't. Get up for me. Isn't there a woman among the girls in the neighborhood of our people? Do you have to go and get a wife from the uncircumcised? My brothers, I know there's some fine sisters in this church. I know, amen, there's some sisters that love God and they look good too, amen. Why you go into the strip club, amen, trying to make her your wife? You think if she been stripping for everybody else, she could stop just because you put a ring on that finger? No, you miss and not have the money coming in like it's supposed to come in. And one day you're going to see her back on the pole. Look at somebody, say, welcome to Relevant, welcome. And so he says, is there not one? Why you have to go to the uncircumcised Philistines? Can I just talk to some of y'all sisters too? Because I know, amen, y'all always talking about man shortage in church. But can I just tell y'all, there's some brothers that love God. There's some good looking brothers. I just see one sister start looking around, say, boy. You know how Jesus said, I know what y'all was thinking. I just hear one of y'all sisters say, Pastor Dury in a different church. Let me hurry up because y'all getting bored. Let me hurry up. So, but Samson said to his father, get her for me. She's the one that I want. Whoop, whoop, whoop. She's the right one for me. Watch this. He ain't say, get her for me. She's the right one for me because she can help me rule Israel. She ain't say, get her for me because I believe, Daddy, that that's a woman that could pray for me and lay hands on me when things get tough. He ain't say, Daddy, get her for me because I know one day when I get my back up against the wall, I need a strong woman on my side. He ain't say, get her for me, Daddy, because I believe that she's the right kind of woman to grow up children in a spiritual way, the way y'all grew me up, Mommy and Daddy. No, he said, get her for me because she looked good to me. Watch this next screen. Amen. Go ahead. Amen. See, the devil can make the wrong things look right. Woo! Look at somebody, say, tweet that. See, I already tell y'all the devil is well proud of. Y'all think he's the guy on the hot sauce bottle with the big pitchfork. No, the devil has come looking just the way you want him to look. What you like? You like a little bit of salt on the head? You know, white hair? What you like? You like them looking like Denzel Washington? What you like? George Clooney? No. What you like? Drake? What you like? You like J. Cole with them big thick eyebrows? Nobody's perfect, no. Nobody's perfect, no. But you perfect for me. You ain't know them from, amen, the back of your hand. But yet you looking at something, you like it, and the devil knows just what you. Oh, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brothers, can I just tell y'all this relevant? Some of y'all married brothers, you better be careful, because I tell you it's a process. See, the secret of your strength is God. The secret of your strength is your commitment to God. But the devil will say, you know what? I know he married. Amen. But watch this. I could send someone his way that could have him singing, Lord, don't let me cheat on my girlfriend or my wife. You're gonna be praying, Lord, don't let me cheat. And if I get caught, just don't let her, amen, her kill me. Because, amen, she gonna kill me if she catch me. But Lord, you praying, why? Because the devil knows how to make the wrong thing look. How much of y'all tired of getting swing? One brother just put 2 wee on up. Looked like he was ready to throw his leg up too. Everybody say it's a process. So watch this, y'all. Amen. It's a process. It didn't happen overnight. Amen. The devil made the wrong thing look right. It's a process. It happens over time. Let's watch this. And it starts by one thing. Amen. It starts by the process. It's a process. And it's a pattern, because watch this, y'all. Then he went, yeah, there's a process and pattern. Everybody say process. And we ain't get to the pattern yet, because the process start with this woman from Timnah. The pattern you'll see when we come to Delilah. Let's go back to that scripture. Then he went down to Timnah and spoke to the woman. So daddy done do his thing. Daddy done go and make arrangements with the family. And so now Samson saying, oh man, thank you, daddy. Now I go down to this daughter and I could kick it with her. And I could let her know how I feel, and I could just throw the ring on this finger, and boy, I could have an eye candy on my shoulder, daddy. Thank you. So Samson goes down, amen, and he spoke to the woman, and in Samson's eyes, in whose eyes? No, it says God's eyes. No, it says God's eyes. In whose eyes? Look at your neighbor, say, I pray you get God's eyes. And see the things that only he could show you. And see the things that are more than skin deep. You got to go deep into the heart. Look at somebody, say, I want to know his heart. Look at somebody else, I want to know her heart. Hallelujah. Why? Because when she shows up, I don't just want me to be, amen, pulled away and lured away by the external. I need to know the internal. Amen. So he went down, amen, and she in his eyes was the one. Let's keep going. Amen, Reese. Let's give Reese a round of applause. She's doing a good job. Amen. The process continues. Judges chapter 14, verse 18. Some days later now, watch this. So he went down, talked to her, amen, let her know what his plans were, and now he was coming back down. Watch this. Some days later, when he came back together, he made a little detour to look at what was left of the lion, because if you were to read this story, you would see that Samson was attacked by a lion. He killed the lion, and watch this. When he made the detour, amen, watch this. He looked at where the lion was left that he killed with his bare hands, and there a wonder. Everybody say wonder. A swarm of bees in the lion's, and don't miss it. I pray you get God's eyes. He scooped it up in his Nazarite law number 2. Don't you eat anything dead, and don't you touch anything dead. Can I just tell you, you will get so pulled in that you will come from the secret of your strength. I'm preaching to every young person. I'm preaching to every adult. Amen. I'm preaching to every person in here. The enemy has been trying to tempt you, amen, to move away from the source of your strength and the strength of your life. I'm telling y'all, it don't happen overnight. I'm telling y'all, amen, it could start with one call. It could start with one date. It could start in one moment and you don't even know it, but yet you are starting to walk away from the secret source of your strength that has set you apart from you were a child in your mother's womb. It's a process. He scooped it up in his hands and kept on going and eating. As he went, he's rejoined his father and mother and gave some of to them, and they ate. But he did not tell them that he had scooped it out, the honey from the lion's carcass, because if he had tell his parents that, they would have absolutely do it. My grandmother do it to me. Go in the tub, stay there till I come. Hallelujah. They would have killed him, because all of what we've been through, Samson, you don't know who you are. You ain't just like everybody else. Samson, what were you thinking? But Samson was in a process that was killing him slowly. The way you know you're drifting is when you allow dead things to feed you. Look at your neighbor, say, Pastor came ready for us today. He came. The sign that you're drifting is when you start letting dead things feed you. You know what? I ain't gonna go to Pastor Dury with this problem, because he only could tell me what I know I need to hear. Let me go to my boy around the way. And I know he ain't saved, but man, he was always there giving me good advice. He ain't got no God in him. No, but man, listen. Man, things been a little tough with me and the wife lately, but I ain't gonna lie. But you know who called me the other day? Yeah, but she called. Yeah, but and your wife ain't giving you none? Nah, but hey. But sister girl, fine though. Yeah. And guess what? You leave there letting dead things feed you. You go to your girl. She in church, but she gossip more, amen, than the Nassau Guardian. And the Punch. Because telling nothing but lies. They changed the story, amen, just to make it sound juicier. But you go and you letting that thing feed you. You going through difficult things, and guess what? You decide I staying away from church. And you start turning on the news. You start turning on your radio, and you start listening to all sorts of music because you depressed. And you listening to all sorts of things. You know, like, you know, what songs y'all listen to when y'all depressed? What Percy Slayer just sing? Who? We talking to an expert over here. Let's go. Someone look like Buddy. She's still inside the 70s. Let's talk to some 80s babies. Huh? Say Sam Smith. Stay with me. That's how I go. Yeah. Yeah, all these things. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Bust the windows of this car. That's a crazy one, y'all. That's a crazy one. But listen. Can I just tell y'all, watch this. Amen. You allow dead things to feed you, because now, watch this, you start taking advice, you start listening, you start surrounding yourself by dead things and dead people. Look at me. When you're going through tough times, don't run from God. You need to run. The process. Everybody say the process. I got to hurry up. Oh, my goodness. Look at the time. Oh, my goodness. So watch this, y'all. Amen. Watch this. It starts off now by him allowing dead things to feed him. So now watch this. Look at your neighbor. Say, he should have bust an MCM anyway. And say, don't touch this. All the 80s babies. He should have bust an MCM and say, don't touch this. So let's go on. Watch what happened, y'all. Watch what happened. So. Oh, yeah. That's what I supposed to tell y'all. Hey, because she say, bust the windows out your car. Right? Can I just tell y'all, when your heart broke, your head don't work. We're going to see this in a minute. See, the first casualty of a heartbreak is reason. Thank you, baby. The first casualty of a heartbreak is reason. Why do I say that? Because all reason leaves your mind when your heart is broken. Okay, you say things to your spouse that you really wish you never said when your heart is broken. Some of y'all listen, when your heart broken, type the email. Cuss them out as much as you want in the email, but don't push send. No, don't cuss. Y'all Christian people, y'all don't cuss that much. Hallelujah, y'all don't cuss that much. See, because when your heart break, it's broken, your head don't work. Some of y'all, amen, can I just tell y'all, watch this. Let's read this story, man. Let's read this story because I want to show y'all how Samson allowed himself to go crazy, touching dead things, and now he's going to have a heartbreak that caused reason to leave his head. And y'all thought breaking windows out your head was out your car is crazy. Watch this, Negro. So Samson's bride turned on the test because here's the context. He gives the riddle to these people. They gone down, he having his wedding, and he have a bunch of people chilling with him, and he drinking wine. Nazarite law number 2 or 3, whatever, there. Don't touch dead things, and let no fermented drink touch. So now Samson, he's sitting to the table. He tell them a riddle. Y'all read the story. He tell them a riddle. And watch this. The riddle was a bragging right on what he did by killing the lion and taking the honey. Because he says, what is strong like a lion and what is sweet like honey? So watch this. They go to his wife, that unfaithful wife, and say, you need to get the riddle from Samson because we losing money. Samson start gambling and even. Samson gone to Island Luckin. Samson was going all of these, he was spinning, but he was winning. And these dudes was getting upset because they say, hold on now, Samson, every day we losing money. We need to find out what this riddle is. So they go to his wife. How could they, first of all, even have the heart to approach his wife? Because if you was my wife, you should have my, because what for me, but because soup, they could have approached his wife, it tells me something about his wife. She was Lucy Juicy, right? So watch this. After they go there, how much of y'all know this good? Look at somebody say this good. You should read your Bible sometime. It's good. I'm telling y'all. Watch this now. So they go to his wife and they say, you got to get the secret. So Samson's wife say, don't worry, I got y'all. Amen. So watch this. So Samson's bride turn on the saying to him, you hate me. You don't love me. So Samson started listening to this song when he come in every night. He was coming saying, baby, give me. She was like this, you know.
No, no, no.
Let them come back to church. So every time he walk inside the room, all he hear is, no, no, no. He's saying, baby, man, you know I love you, man, baby. And all he hearing is, Don Pan, you ain't love me, baby. Mm-mm. You ain't love me. I know someone just say, but I can't believe they play that in church. You play it in your car, right? So every time you can imagine, sisters, can I just tell y'all, y'all could get anything from brothers y'all want. But can I just tell y'all what is wrong with this picture already is because I could imagine, amen, that she was using her body as a requirement, amen, for Samson to give her this riddle. And every time Samson don't give her the riddle, he's saying, man, you, and she's saying, you ain't love me. He's saying, baby, you know I love you, man. Come on, man, you know I love you. And she's saying, no, no, no. Can I just tell every wife in here, your body don't belong to you? And every husband, amen, your body don't belong to you? And when you use your body as a tool to manipulate, that's a Jezebel spirit. Ain't no married brother should be coming to me and saying, "But pastor, pray for me." Ain't no married woman should be coming in here talking to Sister Shari saying, "Shari, I ain't think he loved me because he ain't giving me nothing." No, that's of the devil. I will throw all the oil on you, Crisco. I will throw peanut butter, everything, and anoint you. I don't care how mad you is, how mad you are. But watch this. Let me show y'all how slick y'all woman is. Brothers, I hope y'all got my back. She said, "You have told the riddle to my people, but you won't even tell me the answer." He said, "Man, woman, I ain't even tell my own parents. Why would I tell you?" But she turned on the tares all 7 days. How much of y'all know anything but biblical numerology? 7 means completion. She drove him completely crazy. Watch this, of the feast. On the 7th day, worn out. Some of them brothers, man, I'd be looking at them in praise and worship, and they trying their best. "Pastor, babe, you only know what I just gone through with this woman." Look at your neighbor, say, "He talking to you, not me." Worn out by her nagging. He told her, then she went and told it. Look at your neighbor, say, "Boy, that's a serious process." And so, watch what happened now. She told it to her people, and after she told it to the people, she was the right one, he thought, in his eyes, for him, but watch that, she was the wrong one. So the process continues. And so here's the thing. In chapter 15, verse now, sorry, not in chapter 15, we didn't go there yet. But as he told the people, right? As she told the people, Samson said this. Watch what Samson says. We could go next. Watch what Samson said. The men in Judges 14, the men of the town came to him on the 7th day just before the sunset and said, "What is sweeter than honey? What is stronger than a lion?" And Samson said, "Boy, I wanted to say this a long time, but I just was waiting until I got the opportunity." You know what I mean? It's in the Bible. Watch what Samson said. Samson said, "If you hadn't go talk to that half of mine." Look at somebody, say, "That in the Bible." He said, "You done gone talk to that half of." Say, "If you didn't go talk to that half of, you wouldn't have found out." So here's what Samson said. The process, because when your heart break, your head don't work. So Samson said, "You know what? Samson going crazy. He kill a bunch of people, take their clothes off them and give the fellas who win the riddle, the people clothes. Samson was going crazy because when your heart broke, your head don't work. Hallelujah. And so as Samson was going to do all of this stuff, Samson said, "You know what? I ain't messing with this girl no more." Samson say, "I go into my parents' house." So Samson say, "Okay, this girl done break my heart, so I go in the bus and move, and I go into my daddy's house for a while." Now we go to 15 verse 1. Samson caught himself. He took the time he needed, and so he came back. And watch this. Later on now, he said, "Man, I'm going to go back and get my girl and tell her I love her and I forgive her for all of the stuff she did." So later on, it was during the wheat harvest, Samson visited his bride, bringing her a young goat. "You know, I could carry her a little gift. You know, carry her some flowers, some chocolate and makeup. Tell her I'm sorry for leaving her. And all this stuff, but I come back." He said to the daddy, "Hey pops, hey come on, I just want to see my wife, you know. I want to tell her how much I love her." Y'all are so interested in the story, y'all are reading. Look at y'all. he say, daddy, I love this girl, you know. I bring her a gift. I want to just go make some love to my wife, man. Let me get up there. Let me see your bedroom, whatever. But her father said, "You know what? I ain't gonna let you do that because I concluded that after she done do you so bad, that you absolutely hated her with a passion. So I gave her." Look at your neighbor, say, "Oh my goodness." He said, "I gave her." Y'all know the best man usually in your wedding is either your brother or your friend. We know he ain't had no brother, so it had to have been a good friend. So come on now, daddy, you mean to tell me you give her to my best man? But watch this, see, daddy is a trip. Because daddy say, but man, don't trip over that, because a little sister, finer than her. And y'all thought y'all was messed up, right? So now watch this, his heart broke, so his head, gone. Because Samson, and you could go on and read, Samson gone, and Samson caught 300 fox and tie all, well, some, you know, some scriptures translations is different and say jackals, some say foxes, amen. But they caught them, they tied, he tied 300 of they tail together, light them on fire, amen. Don't look at Samson like that, because some of y'all saying Samson is absolutely crazy. But just ask your neighbor, what's the craziest thing you ever did for love, amen? We don't know, somebody done break windows or car, amen. You done scratch somebody car, amen. You done stalk them on their job walking across the road, amen. You done gone on Facebook, amen. You done Google Earth them, amen. You put a chip on them to find out where their position is. I mean, you just do everything. You done use your friend phone to call their friend, their phone, amen. You done put block on your caller ID, so when you call them, they don't come on. Look at your name and say, what's the craziest thing you ever did for love? Don't answer, because they will want to move their seat. Amen. Can I just tell you, amen, when your heart broke, your head don't work. But Samson was in a process that was leading him from being this anointed judge of Israel to being somebody that will find himself far from the source. So Samson done burned people house down. Samson gonna burn houses down. Samson say, but y'all tripping. Y'all crazy. You give my wife to my best man, and she done stab me in the back. Samson just couldn't take it no more, because when your heart broke, who am I talking to? Because I done say that 3 times. Some of y'all crazy up in here. And God trying to tell you, you need to allow reason to lead you. Because the longer you allow your emotions to lead you, the further away in the process you go from the source of your strength. I'm almost done. So we done burn everything down, right? So watch this, y'all. Here's where Samson starts to continue to go crazy, because now we enter the pattern. Samson now, after he done burned these people house down, he done kill a bunch of them. The Bible says in 16 now, he says, Samson then went to Gaza. I wish I had some Bible readers up in here. But y'all know Gaza is enemy territory, right? So here it is now. Samson went to Gaza. Samson went to enemy territory. He was once a young boy that spent all of his life in the house and in the presence of the Lord. And now here he is in Gaza. He is in a place that he shouldn't be. Some of y'all in that club, y'all look so odd, because you know you ain't supposed to be there. You starting in there and you putting up a front for your friends, and you doing all these external things just to put on, but you know in your heart. Some of you right now in relationships, and you saying to yourself, God, I know this ain't no good for me. I ain't supposed to be here. I ain't supposed to be here, God. Mm-mm. God, you had too much in store for me, man. God, I was set apart. I was different. You put something in my spirit. You gave me a dream. You told some things to me, God, from when I was young. God, how did I get to the place that I am right now? Samson went to Gaza, and watch this, y'all. He slept with her. This is a Nazirite. This is a Nazirite from birth. Touching dead things. Drinking fermented drinks. And now here he is in a place where he's sleeping around with people he have no business sleeping with. Who am I talking to any other day? You're in a place. You come to Relevant Kingdom Center, you like the atmosphere, pastor preaching here, and you know Pastor Cooley's quote all these songs, and even at times he's go a little crazy and play the songs, and God knows what people thinking, and but I like church, you know, but you still ain't where you need to be. Because I don't care how good pastor preach. I don't care how awesome this atmosphere is. Unless you allow God to touch your heart. Unless you understand that there is more that he requires of you. You will find yourself in places you have no business in. And you can't blame Pastor Dury. You can't blame Relevant Kingdom Center. Because at the end of the day, it's still up to you. Oh, I just preached. I wouldn't run around this church. It's up to you. Always looking for Pastor Dury to get you out and give you this word. No, God's saying now it's time for you to get back to the place where you could hear from me again. It's time for you to get back to the place where my hand is on your life again. Stop messing around because you're going further. And once you move through a process, it becomes. And now we go to verse 4. I'm almost done, y'all. Sometime later, how much y'all enjoying this word? Y'all being blessed. Sometime later, he fell in love. Hold on. Your heart just got break. Your head ain't working. You done gone burn people down. Kill people, burn the house down. You done gone to Gaza. And y'all guess what? He was still strong, you know. He was still strong. How much of y'all thankful that in your mess? How much of y'all grateful that when you know where you are ain't where you supposed to be, you still could feel the convicting power of God? You still could feel his presence in your life. Somebody ought to give God praise right there. Amen. Because you understand, God, I know I messed up, but yet you still got your hand on me somehow, some way. I ain't know but everybody else's issues. I know but my issues. And some of y'all saying, before I was saved, no, whilst you were saved, you still did some stuff, but yet is, I need about 5 people just to give him a praise right there, because in the middle of it all, he still got his hands on. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Only real people can shout at that moment, because as messed up, I'm talking about before you was in church. I'm talking about before you knew. I'm talking about while you was in God, while you in church, while you up here singing, while you in the back there, while you at the door. Amen. You know you in some stuff you ain't supposed to be in, but yet you're thankful that you're still here. You still got, amen, strength and health, because his hand is still on. I wish I could have gone into the story. Y'all go read this when y'all get home. Because when he was in Gaza, the fellas here, he was there. And they say, what's Samson doing here? He ain't supposed to even be here. And we ain't even get to Delilah yet. What are you doing here? We gonna kill him now. Y'all know when you in gangs and you go on the next side of town, don't date no one from the next side of town. Because if the brothers hear you in, amen, Shaquay house, amen, Pookie and them coming to get you. But when they came, the Bible says at midnight, because they say we can wait here till in the morning to kill him. But look at somebody say, God had me covered in my mess. Because at midnight, the Bible says that Samson took the doors, amen, off the hinges and carried them up straight to another hill. Why? Because in his mess, he still understand he was still strong. And that's the problem with some of y'all. Y'all believe that you could still be what you want to be and do what you want to do because you still seeing the hand of God on your life. And so you taking that for granted. Granted, let's hurry up, bring this thing home. Sometime later, he fell in love. Some of y'all, amen, you was mad, you mess up, and y'all talking with y'all in love. Some of y'all, the ink ain't even dry on the divorce papers yet. Some of y'all, you just finished sleeping with so-and-so, amen, 2 months ago. That wasn't even, amen, that was a one-night stand. And you talking about you in love. No, baby, your spirit so messed up that you ain't using godly reason right now. Don't make no decision. Look at somebody, say, don't make no decision when you in a bad place. Oh, that's good. That's good. Don't bust. How much of y'all ever bust a move in the flesh? Yeah. Y'all could father look like that. Can I tell y'all, pastor, then bust some fleshly moves. I bust moves on how I was feeling rather than what God was truly saying. So he goes and he falls in love with this woman in the Valley of Sirach, which is called grapes. And her name? Powerful. Say, look at somebody. Say, now we reach Delilah. That's a mess. But it was a process that got a pattern. Now watch this, y'all. Watch the pattern. Let's give Reese a round of applause. No. Not yet. They don't know it, but watch this, because y'all know he was listening to the next tone later on, right? Watch this. He said, how can now, so all of a sudden now, here we reach now, he fall in love with Delilah. Y'all know the story. Some Philistines came down and say, hey, Delilah, come here. Find out the secret to his strength. Hold on now. Didn't the first chick ask him the secret of his strength? Can I just tell you something? Be careful when you're attracted to the same things. Lord, I should have saved this when I go to man to preach. Look at your neighbor and say, be careful when you're attracted to the same things. She said, now, how can you say I love you when you won't even trust me? Three times, because you know he didn't tell her, if you try my hair with a tree, if you tie me up with a tree branch, string, whatever, I could lose my strength. And she's like, come, baby, let me tie you up and see. And he's like, okay, girl, come tie me up. Look at some people say, man could be so silly. So, because from the sister and say, what could tie you up so I could torture you? I would be like, girl, you was absolutely crazy. I'm gone. But Samson was like, I like this mistreatment. Look at somebody say, welcome to relevant, welcome to relevant. So now I love you when you won't even trust me. Three times now, you've toyed with me like a cat with a mouse, refusing to tell me the what? Of your great. She kept at it day after day, nagging. So now I could imagine when Samson walked in the house, he started listening to this song. He's shaking his head. This woman nagging him, and he probably remembering the one from Timnah. And all he asking himself, Samson.
How did you get here? Nobody's supposed to be here.
Oh Lord, and he praying, and he looking at this woman nagging him. Come back in church and stop that thing. I trying to tell y'all this, where y'all at? How much of y'all done listen to a couple of them songs? How much of y'all still listening to some of them songs? And you write, how did you get here? Lord, he done break my heart. But I told you not to touch him from the beginning. Lord, she done do me bad. I told you she was the wrong one from the beginning. But she looks so good. But Lord, he looks so good. I told you to bust a MC Hammer and don't touch it. And now you here talking about, oh, Pastor, pray for me, because I about to kill somebody. My heart break, so my head ain't working. I in a pattern. She kept at it day after day and tormenting him. Finally, he was fed up and couldn't take another minute of it. Some scriptures say he was so fed up to the point he wished he was dead. Some of y'all women better stop. Y'all gonna get judged. Y'all gonna get judged hard. Y'all driving that man. Absolutely. I know y'all. Hey, listen, brothers, if you watching, come to church. Yeah, bring her too. Bring her. I can help you out. You ain't got to pay me for it. He's fed up. Couldn't take another minute. And then he spilled it. Watch this. Let's keep going, Reese. He told her, razor has never touched my head. Carson, let's ride on. He said, a razor must never touch my head. I've been God's Nazarite from birth. Can I just tell you? He knew who he was, even in all of his mess. And I am so glad to know that some of y'all, the reason I could preach to you today and God could touch your heart, because in all your mess, you know who you are. And God is calling you higher today. And God is calling you back up today. And God is saying, I want to set you apart. The secret things that I've given you from you were a child. God says, you still know who you are. I know you messed up. I know you're going places you ain't supposed to go. You're letting dead things feed you. You're hanging around with dead things. But you still know who you are. He said, all my strength would leave me if I shaved my head. And watch this, y'all. Samson, though, was mistaken. He thought it was just his hair. What's the one thing that you believe been keeping you when it ain't been that thing keeping you? You've been holding on to that thing thinking that's what keeps you. Oh, if I go to church every Sunday, then that no. Oh, if I read my Bible every now and then, no. See, because it ain't the external things. Those things are symbols. But watch this. When Delilah realized that he had told her his, she sent for the Philistine tyrants, telling them, hey, come quickly. I got the secret. No, I can't talk right now. Come. Just bring the money. Don't forget the money. Y'all do know Delilah was a temple prostitute. Attracted to the same things, patterns. So she said, come. Tell him the truth. To bring the bribe money. When she got him to sleep, his head was in her lap. Can I ask you a question? If you be honest with yourself, where's your head right now? Where's your mind right now? Some of you, your mind, your head, in a place it ain't supposed to be. You're laying in the lap of danger. And the more you play with fire, the sooner you can get burned. Can a man take fire in his bosom and not be burned? Samson, what you doing here, Samson? Don't you know you were dedicated to God? Remember your mommy prayed for you, Samson. Remember your mommy told you wasn't even supposed to be here. The doctors told me I couldn't even have children. But Samson, God gave you to me. Samson, what you doing here? Samson, don't you remember when you were a young boy, how God moved on your life? What you doing here? Sister, what you doing here? Don't you know that God have a purpose and a plan for you? What you doing here, brother? Brother, no, what you doing here? Why you there, brother? Why you there? You know God got something special for you. That special thing has set you apart from everybody else. Why you here? Why? I'm talking to your heart today. Y'all forgive me for going so long, but man, I'm talking to your heart. God is asking some of you, what are you doing where you're at? I need you to get higher. I'm requiring more. Don't you know what I have in store for you? You were supposed to deliver a nation. You've got nations in your heart. You've got nations in your hand. I'm going to use your life more than you even know or expect or even imagine. What are you doing here? When she got him to sleep, his head on her lap, she motioned to a man to cut off the 7 braids of his hair. Immediately, he began to grow weak. Pastor Dure thought that was in the secret. How come when he cut his hair, he got weak? The Bible didn't say he lost his strength. The Bible says he gets weak. Now watch this, let's go. his strength drained from him. Then she said, the Philistines are on you, Samson. He woke up thinking, I'll go out like always, shake free. He didn't realize it. Now watch this, because this is connected to this. He didn't realize that God, not his hair, God. How long will the Spirit of God strive? I know we always preach in grace, oh yeah, I could do this and live how I want to, but can I just tell you, you're going to wake up one day and you're going to realize that God ain't there no more. And it ain't that he left you, it's you left him. Look at somebody, say, the source of your strength is God. Let's go, Reese. So here's the bottom line. The secret to success and the source of your strength is staying committed to God. Watch out for the process of the enemy pulling you and luring you. And watch out that you don't enter a pattern of giving up the one thing, the one person that's been keeping you. Y'all, I gotta give y'all this and then we're done. I'm promising you we're done. Watch this. Jesus said it better than I could say it. In John 15, he says, live in me. Make your home in me just as I do in you. The same way that a branch cannot bear grapes by itself, but only being joined to the vine, you cannot bear fruit unless you are joined. Look at somebody, say, you ain't gonna make it without him. Hallelujah. Look at somebody, say, you ain't gonna make it without him. I am the vine. You are the branches. You are joined with me and I with you. The relation, intimate and organic. The harvest is sure to be abundant. Separated, you can produce nothing. Anyone who separates from me is dead wood, gathered up to be thrown in the bonfire. If you are blessed, put your hands together. Amen. Put your hands together.